See what I'm talking about? Now, guys, we talked about produce. We talked about the classification of produce. All of them fall under the kingdom of protista, right? Now, when we break it down, what is the main characteristic that all produce have? They're all eukaryotic. We break it down into two more. What do they have? Yes, Michaela. Autotroph, autotroph. What does autotroph mean? It doesn't what? Does what by itself? Help her out. You have to go find your food. I mean, if you're hungry, you want to eat, you got to go get it. So that's what autotroph. Now, we broke it down into three more domains. What were the other three domains we broke it down into? Chris. Not quite. Help him out. Michaela.
One dislike protists, animal like protists, and plant pet like protists.
That's correct. Now, what are the one thing that only animals can have? Yadi. Only animals can have. Help them out. All of them could be multicellular except animal.
Oh, unicellular.
Unicellular. Animal is the only one that animal can only be unicellular, but what can, there's one other thing that animal could be that none of the rest of them could be. Starts with a P. You said it yesterday. Yes. No, protists is what we're reclassifying. Chris, help me out on this. Come on, don't leave me hanging now.
Oh.
Protozoa is the only one that can only be animal-like. Now, what about fungus? It has a single characteristic that none of the rest of them have. Yadi. Reproduces with spores. Now, so now when we did that, oh, you know what? Grab the papers from yesterday. Y'all grab the papers from yesterday. Yes.
So there are different kinds of protists.
Since when? Since when? Michaela?
We classifying protists because protists are like things that they don't have a specific category.
Mm-hmm.
So
So what if we just got rid of all of them? Why don't we just get rid of them? Yadi?
Because they create 50% of the oxygen.
How much of the oxygen?
50%.
So we can't just get rid of them. We need to put them somewhere. Kind of like the stuff we do at home. Like we have nowhere for it, so we throw it into what we call a junk drawer. I probably have about 4 or 5 of those junk drawers myself. And so we have to keep them. So as technology gets better, we actually have to reclassify them. We keep finding out that there are more and more. We keep finding out more and more things about protists. And so we reclassify them as technology gets better. Kind of like when I started out listening to music, I used to listen to music on a vinyl tape. It had this little thing that you stick in the middle of the hole. And that's the only way it played on the record player. And then we went to 8-track tapes, which none of y'all probably never seen before in your life. And then we had cassette tapes, then we had CDs, and now we just listen to it on our phone. And so now, they keep doing the same thing with protists. Can we get one of the lights off, please? Our animals, they fall out of the circle. So, everything falls in domain eukaryotic, just like everything fell into eukaryotic, right? But as we went into the kingdom Animalia, everything is still in that circle, and then we got to phylum Chordata. Phylum Chordata has what? Yes. A spinal cord. So everything still felt into that category, but when we started adding specific characteristics, such as hair, what happened? Yes.
It got smaller because it didn't have all the characteristics.
The group got smaller, you're correct. Now, what did we lose when we added hair? Yes.
We lost the turtle.
They gonna sit there like a bump on a log. We ain't happening it. Huh? What happened? We lost the horse. Why? It doesn't eat meat. So, now, when we went into retractable claws, who did we lose? Anthony. We lost the wolf. Fries, your own groups. I'm gonna give you a new group of animals. You have to look at the characteristics. Where's your paper? You weren't here yesterday? Wow, okay. Now, you're gonna have a new group. You can have that one too. And we look at this sheet here. We look at our domains. As we got more specific, our group became what?
Smaller.
It became smaller. So we're gonna do the same thing with this category of animals as we did yesterday. Now you probably wanna use a pencil on this because you're probably going to be erasing some. So now we have a whole different group of animals. And what we're going to do is we're going to characterize these animals according to their groups. Now, instead of putting the animal kingdom up here, the phylum category, we're going to actually put the animal up here, okay? And we're going to do these group right here. We have our gorilla, our cat, a human being, and then we have a turtle. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna look at each one of these animals or each one of these characters, and then what we're gonna do is find out who all have the same characteristics. The characteristics are gonna be walk upright, animal kingdom, hair, limb, and opposing thumbs. Opposing thumbs are, they have thumbs. So if you were to look at that sheet you have right now, the one I just gave you, what do all... Put animal kingdom here. Guys, put animal kingdom in the first square down here where I have turtle, not a mammal. That's where we're going to put animal kingdom. Okay? That's where we're going to start off at. Now we're going to add the characteristics. And I had it a little bit earlier, but I didn't want y'all to see it. Bingo. Yes. Give me one.
Is it limbs?
Limbs. Okay, she said limbs. Where would we put limbs? In what category? Where would they fit on that tree? Let me get somebody else, Michaela. Somebody help Michaela out. Where would limbs go?
Trout.
Trouts have limbs? Wow. I like the fish, too. I never had a fish reach up and grab me, though. Had them reach up and try to bite me, but not grab me. Yes?
A cat.
Cat. So cat has limbs. Who else?
The gorilla.
The gorilla has limbs. Who else? Yes? The cat has limbs. Yes.
Human
has limbs. Who else?
Sea turtle?
The sea turtle has limbs. Why you say that? Look at the sea turtle. Why do you say sea turtle has limbs? Huh? But you're right now. You're definitely right. He does have limbs. Who else? Yes. But they have limbs. You're correct. They do have limbs. Where would we go next? Tell me. How many?
In the box on the left.
How many do have the fitting limbs?
Because I put
animal
kingdom up here and down here because you said put it up here. Or in there.
But when you put the limb, how many of them fit inside the limb?
Four.
Four of them fit in the limb. So limb is going to be what? Huh? So what are the other characteristics we have? Give me another characteristic. Yes.
Hair.
Okay. Now when you start looking at the animals that we have or the organism that we have, who has Rosalo? Fernando? Yes.
The cat.
The cat has hair, so there's two of them. Rosalie. The human have hair, so there's three of them have the half hair. So, where any more have hair? What about the fish?
Yes.
Fish have hair?
No.
What about the turtle?
No.
Oh, no? So where would we put hair in on our tree? Yadi.
On top of limbs.
On top of limbs, you're correct. Now, what's the next one? Which one we haven't used yet?
Walks
yes, Michaela.
Walks upright.
Walks upright. Fantastic. Now, how many of them walk up? Look at the gorilla.
He walks like that.
When he runs, though, how does he run?
With all four of them.
All four of them. So do you walk upright?
Yes, sometimes.
Does he? He can, but is that his normal?
No.
It's not that one.
Only humans.
The human. Yes, ma'am.
It wouldn't be upright if it's only one of them. It should be opposite thumbs.
No. You're right.
It's
okay. He walks upright. Where would we put walk upright in our tree? Yadi?
In the shortest line.
So we can go ahead and put walk up. We just put up right up there, guys. You don't have to put walk up right. Just put up right. We'll know that's walk up right. Or you can put walk above the line. Like above upright. Why are you not feeling in here? Because she's not feeling up in here. These should go down here. Key to it. This should go inside the squares. So what do we have left? We already used kingdom, limbs, hair, and walk upright. What's left? Yes. Opposing thumbs. Who has opposing thumbs? Yes. The cat has opposing thumbs. Wow, you know what, guys? Hey, when I first got the assignment, I said cat too, but I thought about it. Cat does not have thumbs. Fernando. The baby has thumbs, and who else? Yadi.
The gorilla.
The gorilla. So that would go in what space?
The one under
it. It go right up under. Above what?
Yeah, okay.
Gorilla. So where would we put gorilla? Where would we put gorilla? Okay, that's correct. What are we saying? When we put the cat there, what are we saying? Zilla, help him out. We're saying the sea turtle have limbs. Yes. You had your hand up.
You said.
Help him out.
You said like a crab or something.
The sea turtle was born with this shell. Yes. Now, what I'm trying to figure out, though, is we're saying the sea turtle has an animal. What else are we saying? Yes.
That the cat, gorilla, and
the
human also have it.
The cat, the gorilla, and the human also have it. So now, all we have left is our animal kingdom. And what animal do we have left? Yes.
They all go.
We left out one, though. Yes, Yachty?
Trout.
Trout is the last one in our tree, guys. Now, what we've done is we've created our animal tree. Again, just a diagram of what we're doing and what we're trying to figure out is that everything belongs in the kingdom, right? But as we get more and more specific, our groups actually decrease in size, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And as we become less and less specific, our group actually grows in size. Okay? Now, the other sheet of paper that we had. We had another sheet of paper. Is everybody, everybody have this done?
This?
Yeah.
Yes.
Everybody have this done?
Yes.
Everybody understands it?
Yeah.
Anybody do not understand? Yes. We're basically classified in this particular one, domain eukarya. So all of the ones inside the circle mean that they fit into that classification, correct?
Yes.
So now, when we go in at me on that one, it's the way we classify our species. You need help with that? Let's put our classification system. Mm-hmm. As long as you know that we're classifying them, that's going to be a correct answer. What if we had two or three different animals in the same circle? What are we saying? Yes, Yachty.
They're like, they have similar characteristics.
They have similar characteristics. That's what I'm trying to get you to say. So they have similar or shared characteristics. So we would say, right to this diagram here. Can y'all see this diagram okay? We're going to talk about the horse and the turtle. Why can we not put the horse and the turtle inside the pink? Why? Go ahead. No, okay. Can somebody else help him out? That is correct, but can we help? Can we elaborate on that a little bit more? Juan Carlos.
They have different types of skins and food that they eat.
Okay. Yes. Zola.
Turtles don't eat meat.
That's correct.
They don't eat meat, and a turtle's not a carnivore.
That's correct. And then what else? Yes. That's true. Yes. That's correct. Neither one of the two eat meat. That's why they cannot be into that. Why they cannot be included in the pink circle. So what number was that? That was number three. So if you want to, you can actually put down for number three. Put that down though. For you, you can put yours down. Matter of fact, you and Yada can actually share that one if you want to, unless Yada could come up with another one. Chris, give me one. A lion. Where would you put a lion?
And
do you put him where?
Carnivores.
You will put him there. He will fit into that category, but where else would he fit?
Domestic.
Hmm? Because he can't literally skinny go. Yes, Juan Carlos. Retractable claws. He can get in there. I've never seen a cow eat meat.
Okay, so I think a cow can replace the horse.
That is correct. Now, what other characteristics does the cow have that the horse has? Yes. Rosalie, give me one. What would you replace? What would you exchange? Or guys, you can even just come up with one and tell me what category you want to put them in. Yes. Rosalie? Huh? A what? A lamb? Are you saying lamb?
Oh, it's a llama.
A llama. Where would we put a llama? That's an interesting one there. Where would a llama go? Where would you place him? Where would you put Haley? Not Haley, but Michaela. No? Yes.
A mantis. I would put it with a turtle.
You would put a mantis with a turtle. Thank you.
For a reason.
Why?
Because turtles, they eat bugs, they eat like turtle crickets, and mantis eat those things too.
Mantis eat crickets?
Yeah, they eat bugs.
You ever seen a mantis?
Yeah.
You did?
A praying mantis.
Ah. Oh, praying mantis. You know what I thought you were talking about?
What?
A sea mantis. Oh. Mantis. Gotta tell you a story about that. I was fishing one time at the causeway. And I always fish inside. I don't know what got into me one day, but I fished out in the water about this deep. This old man that I meet out there, he started me going out there at night, getting in the water like this. And one night I was out there and something flew over my head. I'm like, really? Like, really, I was kind of scared because it's probably like 11, 12 o'clock at night. And it was a mantis. Guy, he flew over my head. I got out that water so quick. I'm like, wow, I don't know what I was thinking about. Huh? They're like a big stingray.
Oh, my God.
But they're like, they're bigger than me. I didn't realize that stuff be out there in the causeway. I don't know what I was thinking about, though. I was young and crazy then, though. Just got... Nope. Hair, chicken does not have hair. Look behind, look right to your left. There's one in there. Yeah, but who? Say that again. Man, y'all come up with these animals I never heard of. I need a dictionary for half of those animals. Huh? Oh, well, you have yours from yesterday? Just flip it over.
He wasn't here yesterday.
Huh?
He wasn't here in the morning.
Oh, okay. So. Let's move on to the next question, guys. We probably only have about 9:45. Okay. So we pick an animal. What's number five? What other organism could you include within this diagram? So, guys, if we just wanted to include another organism in this diagram, what could we put in the diagram and where would we put it? Yes. But where would we put the human? Let's see.
Either horse, wolf, or cat. Domestic cat.
Oh. Domestic cat, Michaela. Wolf.
Carnivores, and we have here.
With the horses. Why?
Because we're not vegetarian.
Oh, we could. But we have. Being a vegetarian is a choice. It's not natural for us not to eat meat. Because you think back in the past, there were a lot of times all we ate was meat. Yes.
You said yesterday that the vegetarians say that they don't eat meat, but don't they eat fish?
They eat fish, and guys, I really haven't figured that much out yet. How you could be a vegetarian and just eat only, you eat fish. If you eat fish, to me, in my opinion, and everything that I learned growing up in school is that falls into the meat category, right? I don't know, I was taught that way. Yes.
My friend's vegetarian. She says that she only eats fish because she's a pescatarian.
No, so, you know what? We're going to let them continue thinking the way they think, and we're going to keep it moving. Yes.
We can't be in the horse category because we're not mammals.
We're not mammals? Yeah, we are.
We have hair.
What defines a mammal?
Hair.
Hair and what else?
Teeth.
The way we reproduce? The way we reproduce. That's what defines us. So literally, we actually would fall into the wolf category, though.
Yeah.
You're absolutely correct. Because we eat meat. We fall into that category.
So we don't fall into the horse?
We won't fall into the horse category. We fall right into the wolf category. Yeah. So, what other animal could you add to us? Somebody else add an animal. Chris?
A crab.
A crab. Great. That's, you know what? That's a good one. Because crabs are not up here. Where would we put crab? Yes.
Turtle.
You'll put an animal that would go up in the kingdom of Amelia, but not be in the caudata.
What does
that mean? Caudata means they have a spinal cord.
So, kingdom of Amelia.
Everything is in the kingdom of Amelia. Talk to the teacher next door. Talk to Miss Gaffney. And, because I said the same thing you said yesterday. I said that a snake will not fit into this category because I didn't believe a snake had a spine.
It does have a spine.
It does have a spine.
So right?
Yes, you're right. You know, one caller told us that it had a spine yesterday, but when we looked it up, it just said a vertebrae. Even though our spine are made of vertebrates, I didn't realize that they classified a snake body as a spine. I don't know. We have some eels that can move. We have some slugs that can move. None of those have spines. So speaking of that, what else could we add to the category? Yes.
Salamander.
Who?
A salamander.
What is a salamander? Man, one caller's be stumping me every time. He come up with this stuff. Oh, okay. But where would you put a salamander?
It's like a lizard, but like...
Where would you put him? But does he have a spine? Yes, if he's a lizard, he does.
It's like a lizard because it.
What's another one? Can anybody think of another one that does not have a spine?
Slug
and a snail are the same thing, but actually, slugs do not have snails. Shells. Not, they're not born with them. They actually go get them for housing. Like we're not born in a house, we go get a house. That's what they. No, I did not know that. No. Yes, give me one. And then we're going to move on to the next question.
What about a sponge?
Yeah, you need to be writing the answer down, too. Haley? What makes it an animal? Aren't sponges dead?
What about a squid?
Sponges are not dead.
What are they?
They're plants.
Oh, really? You hear what she say?
Sponges are plants.
I know. They're not. Food.
The only way to die is if they get pulled out.
Yeah, if they get pulled out, that's how they die.
Then they die. Yeah. Now, so, answer for number six. You have your six now?
No. I'm catching up.
You two have to come up with an answer for number six. You two have to come up with an answer for number six. And all three of y'all could do an answer for it. Guys, we're going to hold on for just a second, okay?
No. Please don't be intimidated by the camera. You didn't even know it was there, right? We're doing a video for Kelly, so don't worry about it, okay? You all, I'm going to be in it. They're just going to show you from your back, so that's not going to be an issue, okay? Well, welcome to Kelly Services session number two. This is the nuts and bolts on how to get a job and how to get paid. Now, what I'm going to ask you to do is please don't do any of your writing right now, because I'm going to give you a lot of facts very quickly, how to do things, how to find a job, how to get paid, and those are extremely important things to pay attention to. And you may want to take notes as well, okay? The first thing I want you to do is... in your packet, on the left-hand side, the last piece of information in it is something called Kelly Services Substitute Teacher's Reference Guide. It has a full color page on the front, left-hand side. I'd like you to turn to your page number 4. About a quarter of the way down the page is something called Substitute Teacher's Expectations. Okay, please find that. I apologize for there's no numbers on your pages, but just count to 4. And please read, substitute teachers must always, and substitute teachers must never. Okay, everybody find that?
You said it's on page 4.
Your page 4. In the next one.
Okay, 4. I was counting.
The reverse.
Yeah.
I understand.
But I'm not.
Obviously, you don't teach math. I'm sorry, I like to pick on people. But my rule was I only pick on people I like, so there you go. I used to tell that to my students all the time. You know, the only reason I'm picking on you is I like you. So I used to get from the other kids, well, how come you're not picking on me? Well, I don't like you. What is it going to take for you to know, for you to find out? The one thing that's so important is you always want to keep your students on their toes. And if they, and also try and do things that they don't expect you to do, because they actually like that. They like to hear real life situations, as opposed to the textbook theory that they're getting all the time. And because all of you have such vast backgrounds, that only assists you in the ability to do that kind of stuff. The kids absolutely love it. The wealth of experience that all of you have coming from outside of the educational environment only enhances their ability to learn. So use all that. It only enhances the information they get in the classroom. All right, so I'm assuming that you all have read that on page 4, okay? On top of that, you get evaluated on a daily basis when you substitute. And I have the opportunity and the pleasure to read all those evaluations. And over the last couple of years, I've read somewhere between 5,000 and 7,000 of them. And based upon those, I've developed another list of do's and don'ts that are extremely important for you to be a successful substitute. And I want to go over that. We've had some interesting experiences with substitutes that have come from other areas outside of Florida that truly don't understand the culture in which they're teaching. And therefore, their expectations about what kids know is different than those that have taught in this system before. And we've had occasion where substitutes have called some of our students dumb and stupid. Now, the only people that are dumb and stupid when those remarks are made are the teachers who are saying it, because they really don't understand the culture in which our students live. We have a lot of poverty here in this county. And therefore, some of the students do not have the experiences that other students may have in other parts of the country. So we have to be sensitive to that, okay? Our kids truly try, but understand they're in situations that they can't help themselves. We've had a case of a substitute that even said to a student who was in the first grade or so, what's the matter, you don't know how to tie your shoes? Well, case may have been the fact that they've never had laces to tie. They may not have the proper shoes to even wear. So we have to understand that we are in a very unique culture in Hillsborough County, and therefore be sensitive to those kinds of things. When it comes to medical conditions, if you're a teacher who asked that to a student and the kid said he was okay, turned out to be a broken leg. So it's important that if you see a student that has fallen and appears to be hurt, you call the nurse. If a student says they don't feel well, you call the nurse. You don't have any medical background, it's very important that they see somebody, or at least inform the nurse of that situation. I'm sure in your experience as a substitute teacher, you'll find wonderful lesson plans, because some of the teachers write fantastic lesson plans for you to use. In the last couple of weeks, we've had some substitutes who really enjoyed those lesson plans and wanted to create a file of them and then took them from the teacher without not having a copy, so they had to write another one. So please, if you see a lesson plan, and it's good to keep files of good lesson plans, you have a camera, take a picture, leave the lesson plan on the desk. We appreciate that. In an orderly manner. I'm assuming that you'll get it in an orderly manner. Make sure the chairs are put back to where they're supposed to be. Make sure that the stuff is picked up off the floor. Put the books back on the shelf. That's not your job. That's the student's job. They'll love to watch you do it. Have them do it at the end of the period or at the end of the day. It's important they understand that they have to keep their room neat. You must be on time. You cannot expect to be able to start teaching when that bell rings. First of all, you got to find the school. Then you have to find the office and then meet with the principal secretary. That person, you have to sign in, but don't sign out at the same time you sign in. You have to wait till the end of the day in order to sign out. And then you have to find your classroom, and then you have to feel your way around the classroom so you become comfortable in that environment. Look at the lesson plan. Take the book off the shelf. Read the chapter so that if the student asks you a question, you can give them an answer, because chances are they will. And then you have to get ready to teach. I get stage fright every single day I'm in front of an audience. And I've been doing this now for 42 years. It takes me an hour to get ready to start teaching. It may be the same for you, because I honestly don't know what's going to come out of my mouth. So I have to psych myself up. Some of you will have that same experience. Give yourself that time. It's very important. Okay? I remember my first day of teaching. I had no clue. Really didn't. So I decided to do a slide presentation. And I had never seen a slide projector. You all know what I'm talking about, a slide projector? Because that's years ago. So I put the slides in. And then when I started, Bostonian accent, which you can still hear it. But I talked like this, like Harvard Yard. I mean, I really did. So that thing has changed, thank God. You have to leave detailed notes. And in your packet, you have something called the Substitute Teacher's Report. This is your master sheet. You run one of these off, put your name on it, and leave it on the teacher's desk, because the teacher has to do the evaluation of you. The question then becomes, how can the teacher evaluate me if they're not there? Well, they ask the students. They may ask the teacher next door. They may ask an administrator if the administrator got involved in the classroom. Well, what happens if it's a bad evaluation? We do not take that at face value. We actually investigate that to make sure that whatever is said here is real. Now, if it's a good evaluation, we don't necessarily check that. But if it's a bad evaluation, we certainly want to make sure that it's accurate. Okay? So your job, again, is to leave this on the desk with your name on it. It's not your responsibility to make sure it gets into us. It's the teacher's responsibility to get it into us. So don't worry about that part of it. Okay? Also, in your packet, you have something called the Glossary of ESE Terms. For those of you who want to teach special needs, this will give you a clue as to what kind of special needs you can expect in the classroom based upon the initials that would be next to the class. And we strongly urge you that if you haven't been trained, it's okay to teach in a special needs class, provided that you call the school to make sure there's a paraprofessional who will be working with you, so that if anything happens, that you try if you feel comfortable enough to do that. You have to be. I'm glad you asked. We have just got approval to start teaching the basics of teaching special needs to substitutes. Who is a retired principal, has a PhD in special needs. He's going to be teaching it. And that's going to be fantastic, because now what will happen is anybody who wants to take that extra course will get the basics of what to may go throughout the entire country. So you're very fortunate being here, really. It's a great thing for us to have. You have to be flexible. The assumption is you go into a school to teach a particular subject. But when you get there, they say, no, I'm terribly sorry. Things have changed, and now you're going to be teaching X. You would thought you were X. Take the job. The reason I suggest it is because, first of all, you want to become friendly with the principal secretary, who's an amazing person to begin with, and being friendly with them certainly only helps you. And for those of you who want to be something else, to let the kids know that I am not particularly happy with the noise I hear in the classroom. The usual way I do that is by becoming very silent. And that usually works in my behalf. Really does. Exactly the opposite of trying to get them to stop by yelling at them does not work. But being silent does. Make sure you know how to take attendance. Make sure that you account for every single student all the time. Do not let any student take attendance for you, because that may not necessarily be accurate. And when you take attendance, make sure that you count the number of kids in the seats as well as the check marks to make sure they equal. There's 2 to 3 teachers every week that fall asleep in the classroom. Oh, you laugh, do you? Let me show you a picture. Well, as long as you mention that, I had a student fall asleep in the first row of my class after 10 minutes after the class started. I got it. Good. I said to the whole class, shh, everybody leave. I had everybody walk out of the classroom. I shut the blinds, shut the lights out, turned the clock to 5 o'clock. And then I had his friend wake him up. I thought he was going to pass out because he thought he missed his 2 tests. Then I came into the classroom. Like I said to him, are you going to fall asleep in my class again? Oh, what time is it? Well, it's only 10 minutes from the time you came into the classroom. It was only 10 minutes past 9. He thought it was 5 o'clock. See what I mean about having fun in the classroom and keeping the kids on their toes? They never knew what to expect. Do not leave students alone, and do not leave. You're held responsible for anything that happens to those kids in that class. If an emergency happens, because you may have some young children at another school, if an emergency happens and you have to leave, you call the administration first, have someone relieve you before you can leave the classroom. Okay? Don't give out snacks. You don't know what allergies the kids have. Don't break up fights. It's not your responsibility. Your responsibility is to call the office and have someone come down to handle it. Don't try and break up the fight. You could be seriously injured, or you could injure a student. Found out somewhere else, they're the one that gets in trouble. So you write this pass specifically. You don't let anybody else leave until that child comes back. And if the child is gone for more than 10 minutes, I'm on the phone with the office, I have a student that's escaped. Shouldn't take longer than 10 minutes, okay? There are a number of schools that don't allow passes to be given out for any reason. But good, now the teacher was being investigated as well. I told you to bring non-latex gloves with you. Remember that, non-latex gloves? I used to say put one on. That doesn't work anymore. Forensic science is now so good, it actually can see through one non-latex glove. Put both of them on. And then your fingerprints will not appear on the contraband. And that's the better way of handling it. And then write a detailed description of what happened from the time you saw the contraband until the time it was put somewhere. Don't take videos of students. We had a case 2 weeks ago of a teacher who took videos of the students and said they erased it. But you know, when you're using your phone, it doesn't get erased. It goes up to some cloud somewhere. I still don't know what that means. Cloud should be getting very heavy by now. You're not trained. They're the ones that are supposed to do it, or the nurse is supposed to do it. So be careful with that. There's too much liability involved. Don't give out stuffed animals. Sends a wrong message, plus the student could be allergic to the hairs. One of the little kids could eat one of the eyes. And the stuffing is toxic. So please, a class in political science or religion, because it's an elective in the high schools. Again, you have to take all sides or right down the middle. I always got the question, because I've taught political science, who are you going to vote for? Oh, I'm going to vote for the best candidate. That's what I tell them, assuming there is one, that is. Now, you notice I didn't take any sides here. That makes a heck of a lot of sense. Okay, so that's why we even brought that up. When it comes to proper dress, business casual, no jeans, no heeled shoes. Ladies, if you wear heels, they cannot be taller than 2 inches, and they have to be at least an inch wide. And that's not because we're doing a fashion statement here. It's because we don't know what kind of surface you're going to be walking on, and we don't want you to trip and fall. You know those graded stairways going up to the second floor of those open-air classroom environments? The narrow heel will go in, but it ain't coming out. You'll fall over and hurt yourself. If you're going to stand on something, do not stand on a chair. Do not stand on a table. There are stools designed specifically for that. Or find a taller student to help you out. We don't want you to trip and fall. And be careful where you walk. The kids leave their stuff all over the floor. So please, we don't want you to trip on anything that they may leave there. Okay? Very important. Okay, so now, part-time clerical. We didn't get into the educational environment until about 1990. 1990, right? And now we're in over 6,000 school districts around the United States. 2.2 million classes filled by Kelly substitutes. Over 23,000 a day. And combine those two, we represent 10% of all the absences in two districts. Now, granted, we have very large districts. Some of the districts only have 20 people in them. But still, 10% represent two districts here in Florida. So we have a lot. That's why 2,000 substitutes. And Monday's a busy day. I'm here from 9 o'clock till 12 o'clock, 4 days a week. Between 9 and 10, if you really need to speak to somebody because there's something that is very important for you to talk to, call me on my cell phone. I'll walk it over to somebody so that you'll get to talk to somebody immediately. All right, you all have my phone number. If you don't, I'll give it to you, okay? So you're going to work with the Kelly office. Web time, 3 o'clock in the morning. It's in the bank. Now, how do I know that? I'm OCD. I check every week. And the reason I check every week is because I don't know how it knows how to get into that bank. I'm still fascinated by GPSs. How the heck does it know where my car is? Same thing. So I just check to see if it's in the bank. And sure enough, it's there. I've been working for 2.5 years, almost 3 years for Kelly. Not one mistake. So that's a very good figure. Standard policies, harassment, safety, equal employment opportunity, drug-free workplace. You know that you signed an affidavit allowing us to drug test you, right? So watch out for poppy seed bagels and muffins. You'll test positive for heroin. If you don't believe me, all I have to look at Seinfeld. Elaine got in trouble because she couldn't go on the trip with her boss. I like poppy seed muffins anyway, so I... Now, please... No, wait a minute. You can't buy a pound and then consume it and expect to get high. You'll just get sick. Right away, the wheels start turning, you know?
How long does it take to get up?
Who said that? I got a heckler here in the front.
Just one bagel will...
Now, you have to understand. Please. It all depends on your metabolism. Most people, it would take about 10 of those bagels in one day for it to happen.
What about poppy seeds on bread?
Here's the situation. You have to count all the poppy seeds. If you have more than 12, don't eat it.
Okay, it's more than 12.
You have to count the poppy seeds before you eat the...
Yeah.
There's always one in the crowd. Okay. And do us a favor, please don't bring any weapons to class. Okay. The reason why we bring that up is, don't forget, there was a bill going through the Florida legislature that would have allowed teachers to bring loaded weapons into class. That got defeated.
Are you crazy?
It got defeated.
Crazy.
Okay. Yeah. So again, I believe in the state of Florida, mace and pepper spray are not considered weapons, and I know some people carry that. In the state of Florida, some states it is, but not in the state of Florida. Workplace violence and 150 days. If you are required to work more than the bell to bell, you have to get approval by Kelly first. Now, that can happen in some of the elementary schools where they did not pass the English part of the standardized testing. Ever get into one of those schools, you will be asked to work an extra hour, perhaps. You have to get let Kelly know ahead of time, okay, so you get paid for that.
Now, what if you are one of those that likes to go in an hour early or whatever it is?
Bell to bell.
Okay,
I go in, I'm in school about a half hour ahead of time. I don't get paid for that extra half hour.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
You start when the bell rings.
Okay.
Yes. Hours.
Yes, but on early release days.
6.67 hours. That's Monday.
Okay.
Every Monday's the early release day.
Right.
Question?
No, but just listening.
Okay. Some of you may have that status.
What did you say? Can you repeat what you said about the dollar more?
Yeah, if you have a five-year certification, mm-hmm. then and you are picked to go to a Title I cert, that starting next year, school will start on August 10th, this coming summer, and it will be ending in May. June will no longer exist.
Okay.
Now, I did have a substitute who thought that it was being eliminated from the calendar and got very upset. And don't forget, I'm standing up here as the teacher, and everything the teacher says is supposed to be true. And they sometimes, a group of freshmen, college freshmen, because they asked me what kind of tests I gave. I said, I give essay tests. How many questions? 100. How much time do we have? 10 minutes. And they're writing all this stuff down. I said, does anybody think that this may be wrong? Oh no, you're the teacher. Can't teach you anymore, you've now learned. It's important that it's amazing how you can see the difference between it's a pleasure to watch the transition. For those of you who have taught high school, from freshman to senior. You know what I'm talking about, for those of you, how many of you have middle school?
No.
Middle school? No,
I think that experience.
You experienced middle school students?
I've taught middle school for 8 years.
For how many?
8.
And she's smiling. And doesn't have gray hair yet. Isn't that wonderful? Good for you. It takes a special person to teach middle school. It really does. They are very unique kids. They're wonderful kids, but they're going through so many transitions at the same time. Their bodies are exploding in all sorts of different reasons, okay? And how they deal with that is beyond me. Plus the peer pressure and the experimentation. It's the age of experimentation. You all know that, right? Because you lived through it. If there's an incident concerning a student or a full-time teacher, you got to report that. If a school district requests you for future assignments, you've got to report that as well. Now, that's perfectly okay. You can go out 3 months. A teacher said, I need you for the following days. You can certainly do that as long as it's in the system. No, you're going for one teacher, and now they assign you to another teacher. You have to let Kelly know so we can adjust it in the payroll system. Also very important. If the assignment is for you to leave campus, like on a field trip, you've got to let Kelly know. That can be very difficult. I'm not an advocate of sending a substitute out on a field trip. Buses. Everything's fine during the field trip. Now, 4 buses leave, you're short one kid. You can't leave. You have no way of contacting the other buses unless there's a communication system. And you don't know the faces, you don't know the names. That's why it's very difficult to send a substitute teacher on a field trip as the person in charge. If there's a teacher going to be on that bus and they're in charge, but you are an adult going with them, that's a different story. Okay. So I'm going to tell you some questions that museums. I was at Legoland. It was a 25% reduction on the cost of the ticket.
Is it good for substitute teachers too?
Yeah, I'm a substitute teacher.
Okay. Regular teachers is free at
Lavernica teaches it's free?
It's free in Legoland and SeaWorld and Florida Aquarium.
Really?
Yeah.
I could have told them I was a full-time teacher. I still have my ID from where I was full-time. Damn it. I gotta be careful, he's taping.
Teacher badge that could work really anywhere if they give out teachers.
On top of that, you're going to get something called Kelly Perks. And Kelly Perks is a whole list of all the discounts available to Kelly substitutes. There are hundreds of them, if not thousands. I bought a new car, and there's a discount on the car service. I got $3,125 deduction off the cost of my car.
Really?
Wow. Now, I don't know if they would give it to me anyway, but I had the certificate from Kelly. And it told me what dealership to go to, and they accepted it. And I got a good deal. I was happy. Okay, so that stuff does work. And that's available to you within the next couple of weeks. You'll start getting those emails every, I don't know, it's a Tuesday or Wednesday. The badge has a 5-year expiration date and $5 charge if you lose the badge. Okay, you come out here and get a new one. You must have a valid working phone number, email address, and mailing address. If any of that changes, you have to let Kelly know. We have to be able to communicate with you at all times because that's how you get your jobs. Now, if you get injured, you have to let the school know and Kelly know immediately, assuming you're conscious. If you're unconscious, as soon as you're physically possible to do it, okay? You're going to have to fill out an accident report or an injury report. That could be done over the phone. And if you need medical help, our medical team will get in touch with you to make sure you get the fastest and best medical care. Okay? Now, an incident is any occurrence, accident, or event or allegation that involves a Kelly employee. And if you're not sure if it's an incident, if it's not, guess yourself. You're always safer to make the phone call. Now, a physical contact resulting in injury to a student substitute, Hillsborough County employee, or third party. Injury to someone in the presence of a Kelly substitute. Property theft or damage, inappropriate physical contact activity that could be defined as sexual harassment, or inappropriate or offensive language. Now, that's not between two students. Have you ever walked down a corridor of any school? You'd be calling every 5 minutes. It's between a faculty member and a student. Because we had a case of a sixth grade teacher who used the F word with a student in front of the rest of the class. That's not good. It's between two faculty members in public going after each other. It's someone who is not acting appropriately to you, not treating you as a professional. If you're at a school and you're not being treated as a professional, call us. We need to know that. A call would be made to the principal of that school. Inappropriate physical contact. Let me give you a couple of examples of that. Now, this was at the college level. I took a summer abroad program to South Korea with 30 students. And there was an awful lot of students to take by myself, so I invited another faculty member to go with me. Hotel room, barefoot, with what appeared to be her shoes under his bed. I had no choice because I worked for a very conservative school. I had no choice but to make a phone call immediately to the vice president of the university and write a detailed report that had to be submitted immediately or else I could be fired. There was a hearing. Somehow he kept his job. I still don't know why or how. But the person reporting me didn't know it was my daughter, had every right to report me. So the dean still is a friend of mine, and he said, I understand. And then I said to my daughter the next time I saw her, don't come near me for the next 4 years. Because it'll just happen again. I was fortunate enough to have my daughter and my son as my students, as well as my wife. And my wife that all have marketing degrees, because that's just what I taught. I'm the only one that doesn't have a marketing degree.
As far as now, can you teach a class that has your child in it? Or?
So that's we can't say, this whole can't. Sometimes you have no choice, okay? Use the hula hoop approach. Don't ever go closer than 2 feet to a student because by accident you could be touching their clothes, which is the same as their skin. So always stay within that, away from that 2-foot circle. I can understand why they don't like being in that class, okay? But I took it because I had to. You must stay on school grounds at all times. Don't even go to your car. Stay within the boundaries of the school. Has anybody here spoke? This is amazing. I have to tell you. You're the first person in 2.5 years that has actually raised a hand. Now, either everybody's lying. I'm absolutely amazed. You're the first, honest to God, I've asked this question for 2.5 years. You're the first person to raise a hand. I have no problem with that. I'm an old smoker. I've smoked for years. I haven't smoked in a long time, but still. You can't go to your car to smoke. You have to get off the campus entirely, on the road, going home. Okay? So please, hold off. Now, employee benefits. You get a weekly paycheck. We already talked about that. You have your direct deposit. E-pay stub. You get your pay stub every Friday somewhere between 10 o'clock and 1 o'clock in the afternoon. You download your pay stub for your records, same way as you would find go on the payroll system. You also get your W-2 the same way at the end of the year, which is really convenient. This year it came out the third week in January, which is really good. Kelly bonus program. You're not eligible for the bonus program this year. You have to work at least 130 days. Once you work 130 days in any given year or longer, you can get between 1% and 2% of your annual salary as a bonus, right? The first bill you pay is to yourself. Start saving right now. You're going to need $1.8 million when you retire at the age of 70, because that's going to be the retirement age when you're ready. I just saw the statistic last week, $1.8 million. You'll still have Social Security. It'll still be there. But now's the time to start saving, 401k, wherever you can do it. Group medical plans are available to you. And it's a really good plan. It's a menu plan, so you can pick it. Training versus Kelly, via Kelly Learning Centers. There's a whole bunch of training modules that are available to you. Management, human resources. If you have time and you're interested, just pull them down. There's about, I don't know, 3,000 of them. There's tons of them. Assignment flexibility simply means that you pick the days that you want to work. Now, we may have some night people here that don't like to be called before 9 o'clock in the morning. Too bad. You're in substitute now. You're going to be called 6 o'clock, 6:10, 6:30, any of those areas, okay? So don't be surprised. Or you can do it online. My preference is to do it online, and I'll start somewhere after breakfast for the next day, and I'll go on every hour on the hour. When I'm at home, when I get nothing to do, I sit with a tablet on my lap, and I'm always playing on something. So every hour I'll get back on to see if there's something at my favorite school in my favorite subject, because I'm very particular about what I teach and where I teach it. And I'll keep looking. Now, if I don't see anything by 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock at night, I'll give up for that time. But in the morning, as soon as I get up at 6 o'clock, I'll go back online, because there could be as many as another doubling of the amount of offerings that are available. Teachers call in late. So don't be surprised if the amount of absences double overnight. And look again. You never can tell what you may find. Remember, no dashes. Your PIN number is the last four digits of your Social Security number. Hopefully you remember that. Okay? So, we're going to go on ASOP. We're going to find a job. We're going to press on ASOP. As soon as you press on that, up come the sign-in sheet. The blue squares are jobs that you have already taken. It keeps a record of all the jobs that you've already taken. That's a good thing. I keep a personal record of that as well. I have a date book. In that date book, I put down the job. That way you don't need two books during the year. It runs from July to June. Works out very nice. You get it from At a Glance is where I get mine. I've been using the same date book for 43 years. And I've saved every single one of them. I'm OCD, but that's beside the point. As a teacher, you want to know when you start a lesson and you stop a date book, so that next year, when I'm ready to start again, I've got all those dates, all that information sitting there as my standard operating procedure. So for a new teacher, that's a marvelous thing to hold on to. Okay? And if you become a mentor to another teacher, you have this kind of information that only a long-term teacher has, and it's very valuable. I've saved every single test I've ever given. Or not, I still use them. I was asked to teach world history to 1500, which is one of my areas that I like. And I used a textbook that I got in 1961 and the notes that I saved from my teacher, knowing at some point I was going to teach it. And it followed the textbook I was using, ancient history. He said, "Those are awfully old notes to use." I said, "It's old history. It didn't change." See, sometimes you get teachers. You know. The green ones are the jobs that are available. You could click. I'm an advocate of seeing all of them because I want to plan ahead. So in this particular instance, I'm going to press on available jobs. Oh, and all of those come up. Let me go back for a second. Remember when we clicked on to get this? This is your web time. So as soon as you sign in and the 3 months come up, to do your payroll, that's the web time you use to do your payroll. Okay? You all got that? So now I see all the jobs that are available only at the schools that I have chosen. Okay? It tells me the day, the date, the time, whether it's a half day or a full day. A half day, and you can take half day assignments, a half day is considered a full day for the 4 day requirement. Okay? Now, if by some chance you could possibly do 2 half days at the school, if that doesn't work, call me. She didn't call me, so I am assuming she found the school. Because so do a dry run if you possibly can. It'll save you. And some of those GPSs take you who knows where. Okay? So now here are all the schools, all right? Now, again, if you don't see anything you like, just get off the page. You don't have to sit there and reject every single one.
That's exactly what I was just going
to
ask.
Yeah. There's no need to.
Okay.
So just get off the page.
So you're just accepting what you want, that's it?
Yeah.
Okay.
And if you don't say anything you like, that's it. Now, there's one extra thing here that I didn't point out. It's this blue box. That blue box is a note that the teacher leaves for you about something that's going to go on in the classroom. So always click on the blue box. So in this particular instance on Sarah Kraft, I click on the blue box that says, "Plans are on my desk." Hopefully there's only one desk. I got one of those notes once. There were 3 different desks. Didn't tell me which one. Took me almost the entire 20 minutes I was there early to find the assignment. It could be that simple, or it could be the entire plan, or it could be nothing at all. It all depends what the teacher wants to do. I want to teach science in middle school. As soon as I press accept, up comes my for your confirmation number. Keep it in your files. That's a guarantee that it's your job and you're going to get paid. So keep that. If you don't get that right away, someone stole the job from you. So you have to go back into the system and get another job. They were there a millisecond before you and they grabbed it. Okay? There's only one time where that can't happen, is if you're a preferred sub and they put your name on it, you're the only person that sees the job. And that's a very good thing. It didn't happen with Hillsborough, it did happen with Kelly, that you're the only person that sees the job if you're a preferred sub. Now, let's say there's a day you don't want to work. I don't feel like it. I don't want to deal with kids. I want to just veg out. I want to go to the beach. So I press on the 16th, and up comes add non-work day, which you're entitled to do. So days you don't want to work. You don't have to put a reason. You just click on, okay. If you need to change any of this stuff, you press on preferences. First one is personal information. You can change any of your personal information, okay, by pressing edit. You want to change your PIN number, the old PIN number, and then put down the new PIN number, okay? That's simple. Now, what a lot of people do is they put in the new PIN number and couldn't get in until someone told me. So please, when you do all this stuff, press apply, and then it'll work, okay? Now, when it comes to schools, all the schools are now listed. That way, you're pretty much guaranteed the 4 days a month. We want you to work more, but that'll guarantee you the 4 days a month, okay? I'm now I'm in 2 schools. I'm going to expand that out to 5 schools. Right now I teach in East Bay and Leonard High School. I'm going to expand out to Bloomingdale, Riverview, and Newsom.
Is there a way to
Yes.
Okay.
We don't recommend you do that. Let me go back here for a second. I avoided that.
So why did NASA use liquid rather than gaseous reactants to power the shuttle's booster engine, a booster rocket? Think about what's the difference in a gaseous state versus liquid state. What are the five factors which are required for a collision to take place? Yeah, go ahead.
It allows for more collisions.
So yes, you need more collision, but why? You know, you can have the collisions in the gaseous state also. There's no temperature yet. Go ahead. Reaction rate, you are on the right track. Kelsey.
Concentration.
Absolutely, concentration. In the liquid state, there are more molecules. So the chances of collision happening will be much, much higher. Okay? On activation energy, tomorrow's work. Today, just to remember, activation energy is the energy which is required, the minimum energy which is required for concentration of reactants or product per unit of time, change in the concentration. Again, the concentration is measured in liters, in moles per liter. And since we are doing this reaction rate, there is a time like there in your textbook, you will be looking. And most likely, either tomorrow or day after on Monday, we'll be working on these things also. These are these five factors affecting in yesterday's video. The nature of reactants, if you guys remember, the two students were mixing in the solid state and nothing happened. And then they used the aqueous state and what happened? Let's see, how many of you remember?
Turn yellow.
What second thing which was dropped in that one?
Oh, that was potassium.
Magnesium, not potassium. It's a magnesium strip that was dropped. No, but again, the concentration is important, okay? The temperature of the reactants. Again, let's recollect from the video what was used as a reactant. Three test tubes with hydrochloric acid. One was frozen for 10 minutes, in ice bucket for 10 minutes. One was on a hot stove plate or hot water for 10 minutes. And one was at room temperature. So which one had the fastest reaction?
Hot one.
The hot one. So the temperature does affect the reactions. Fourth one is surface area. Again, in the video, this girl student, she rolls one of the strip in a wad and drops it there, okay? Which one happened because it has more surface area? And then the last is catalyst. Catalyst does not do anything much except it creates an environment where the reaction can start with less energy, with less temperature, just to get that temperature there. So catalyst will help speed up the process of reaction with less temperature and less energy. That's the only difference. We went over all these words, okay, concentration. It's a simple probability thing. More concentrated something is, then more molecules are there, the probability increases that collisions will take place. It's very simply like one. Nothing to bump against. But what if there are 200? There'll be a lot more collisions. Temperature. When you heat water, what happens? The water starts boiling. Molecules are moving. It's the same thing if I say those 10 people stay in one place, would there be any collision? But if I say, okay, jump around, run around here, they're not going to expose, the probability increases that there will be reaction. And catalyst is again, it only thing does, it lowers the activation energy. It doesn't do anything else. It helps speed up. It does not form any product. It is just kind of like speeding things up. Then, this is one chart I pulled from internet. Orientation of collision is important. And two of the questions on page 564, there's a table, and there are three bullets there, and you need to write some. And if you put hydrochloric acid there, unless you put that hydrochloric acid with proper orientation, nothing is going to happen, as this picture illustrates here. The hydrogen molecule must be filled, a new product will be formed. It will be CH3 chloroethane. So again, orientation is very important. What happens when you are hitting? Don't you need to make contact there? So that's the orientation. So again, this is in the chemical reaction for ethane and hydrochloric acid. The orientation has to be correct. This is the way it has to be to form that chloroethane. That's the quick recap of yesterday's work or yesterday's video. I hope, I'm very sure you remember most of it. Now you have, some of you have this thing. Before we go to this one, tomorrow again, I need your lab for each group. If you have today, I will collect, but keep it on your table. Some of you have this thing in on your table. Those who do not, I will bring it to you. You guys don't have enough. There's one and there's one.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you need paper? Do you need paper?
Here's the one book for you two, and then my book for two, I guess. I can get up and
that's totally a joke.
It's right on.
Any questions, first of all, ask. Okay. Second thing, if you are done, then make sure like you read a little bit about the activation energy, because tomorrow you will be working on activation energy. So then rather than like, you know, spend all the time reading about it, okay, it's much better if you read it today. It will help you.
Thank you.
All right.
Tell me your address.
Can we look up examples for this?
I gave you an example. This is for the whole group. Give me as a whole group.
Yeah, because then
I will, otherwise I will have to kind of like sort them out. If, assuming you guys have done today's assignment, then read about the reaction rate. Because active, no, activation energy.
I think me and Jess have turned it off. Hold on, let me go look.
Yeah, take a look, okay, if it is there.
Could we turn our labs in?
Well, or she said, like, you know, clip them together. You guys know where to do, okay? So if you guys want to, what I'm doing is like collecting from everyone, putting a staple together, so everything is in one place, okay? Again, read about activation energy because tomorrow's work will be on. Again, if you have any questions, just ask, okay? You know, because you need to make sure, like, real life example, the one I gave you about UH.
Wait, is
not
this one for baseball?
Hmm? You tie blindfold, you see. No, what do you hit with the blindfold as a game?
Nothing. Oh, a pinata.
Yeah, don't you need in proper orientation?
So this one would be baseball.
Baseball, pinata, whatever you want. I'm like, I just gave you a couple of examples, okay, basketball. You have to throw it in the proper orientation, otherwise it just goes out of bounds. So use your imagination, okay?
Right.
I'm like, there are other things you can also say, like, you know, hydrogen and oxygen need to combine to form water. How they have to combine. You can use the example I showed you that ethane and hydrochloric acid. The book has some examples there also. But when Ms. Yari says real life example, I would more like go with like basketball, baseball, pinata, or any other. P-I-N-A-T-A with an accent over A. It's a Mexican word, okay? So, again, when you are done, make sure you read some of the other things. Kelsey, after you're done, read about the activation energy. Tomorrow's work will be on that. So use your time wisely, and I know you guys will be done in about before 10 o'clock. So use the remaining 20 minutes wisely. I will be collecting your responses.
Yeah.
Three could be
forming a new product. It's like the oxygen in the air is combining with apple.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you are forming like your oxide thing. So reacting substance must provide with sufficient energy. Now the rusting takes place very slowly. Like, you know, you have like an exposed iron plate. It's exposed. It doesn't rust in 1 day or 1 hour. It takes a long time. But suppose something is there, like in a rainforest, would that rust quickly versus something in a desert?
Yeah.
Why?
We'll say that. You can't just say, you know,
today I missed a couple games. I will find it, okay? Don't worry about it.
Okay.
Recording the cost of culinary department. So you can use the same thing here. Put these turquoise paper in the bucket, please. When you guys are done with the turquoise paper, back in the bucket.
So
if you make sure that
Things coming up. We're going to the zoo tomorrow. You're going to do a report on animals. How many of you guys have picked your animals already? Good. Who have you picked? Do you know?
Elephant.
Elephant.
Cheetah.
Cheetah.
Rhino. Seal.
All right. We got some great ones. Well, today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to read you a book, and it might help somebody. It might help somebody. All right, do while I'm reading the book is also think about some things you've learned about text features. And we're going to have a little fun game afterwards. So I want you to put your listening ears on and your thinking caps. And are you guys ready to hear something about what?
Elephants.
So, one of the books, well, tell me first of all, what kind of book do you think this is, just by looking at some of the text features? Yeah? Izzy?
A nonfiction book.
Nonfiction, what would give you that idea?
The photographs.
The photographs, and what else?
And the title.
The title.
What else? Table of contents.
The table of contents. We haven't read it yet, but let's go ahead and look at some of the, what do you think about informational boxes? What?
Sidebars.
Sidebars, good, 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 that's good. All right, so let's
title page.
All right, and this is the?
Table of contents.
Oh, you guys are gonna do awesome on this little game we've got going on. So, in the table of contents, we've got On the Move, Everything African and Elephants, Enormous Appetites, Sticking Together, Tough Travels, and Full Cycle. Those are some of the chapters that we have. And we're going to cover a couple of them because we don't have a whole lot of time to cover all of them. But let's go ahead and move on to, what is this?
On the Move.
Can travel up to 90 miles a day, has tusks used to dig for water and find food, is the largest land animal on earth.
Walrus.
A walrus. Good guess. Good guess.
Elephant.
Elephant. Absolutely. And elephants live in Africa and Asia. This book is about elephants that live on the southern border of the Sahara Desert. Do you guys know where the Sahara Desert is? No? The Sahara Desert. We got a great, what is this called?
Map.
Elephant. An African elephant is so big, it makes a 6 foot, some of your daddies or mommy's 6 feet? That's about a foot taller than me. It makes makes a 6 foot tall man look small. So see that? Here's some more text evidence, or text features that kind of show us the scale, right? Here's a big elephant and a small little man. What humans normally live. They are the largest land animal on earth. Their ears keep elephants cool by releasing heat. Their feet are hoofed with spongy pads that absorb weight. So to carry around all that weight, they need to have some spongy pads in there. Kind of like sneakers, right?
Yeah.
When you jump around. Their trunk is used for smelling, drinking, breathing, trumpeting. What's trumpeting? You got it. That's what they eat. Well, who knows what a herbivore is? So they eat only plants, such as roots, grass, fruit, and bark. Elephants need to eat a lot of food to fuel bark. 300 pounds per day. That's like eating four of, who said they were? Yeah. You're, well, no, who said they were about 70 pounds, 75?
I'm 73.
That's eating like about four of you. Or that's like eating 1,200 hamburgers.
Yes, I would go for that.
Can you imagine driving elephants form a group called a herd? Herds are led by an older female and usually have 6 to 12 elephants. But in some areas, much larger herds have been seen. Females stay with the same herd their entire lives. But male elephants remain with the herd only until they're about 12 or 15, called bachelor herds, or they live alone. Male and female herds migrate separately. So, one of the other things that you guys have you ever heard that elephants never forget anything? Have you ever heard that saying, that they're so smart? Yes, we are.
I actually heard that elephants' tusks are actually used for biting, too.
For biting?
Fighting.
Yeah, to protect. Good one. Thank you. Elephants never forget. Scientists think that elephants have good memories. Herd leaders remember where the best watering holes are, even if they have not been there for several years. So, when they migrate, I may have given you some of it. You're going to kind of have to use your previous knowledge or guess on. And I'm going to split you guys into two teams. This is team
West.
All right. Each of you guys are going to have a turn to come on up, but I'm only going to pick two at a time. And what you're going to do is I'm going to ask you a question. And have you guys ever seen Family Feud?
Yes. It's a great show.
All right. So you got a contestant here from one family. And I'm going to read the whole question. And then you go. You ready? Okay. Question one. Between a nonfiction and a fiction book. All right.
A nonfiction has photographs and also tells about something.
Mm-hmm. There we go. That's the word I was looking. So nonfiction is based on facts. And what?
Nonfiction is made up. It could be stories or creating just like.
All right. Great job. Good try, Haley.
Good try, Haley.
All right. Good try, Haley. So, 1 point. Next.
Wee.
Come on up. Come on, June.
Did you know? Did you know this?
All right. Don't forget, I got to read the whole question. All right. Question two. What is a large group of wild animals? A, hold on. is a group? What is a large group of wild animals? A, a herbivore. B, Mrs. Jones' class. C, a herd. Oh, you can't help him. Oh. Not yet.
Can you re-say it again?
Sure. A herbivore, Mrs. Jones' class, or herd? A herbivore. Not quite. You want to try, Juno? A herd. Boom.
Yeah.
All right. Good job, Wes. How are we doing on time? All right. Let's go ahead. We'll figure it out. All right, number three. What is the name, the place, or environment? And wait for me to finish A, B, and C, okay? What is the name of the place or environment where a plant or animal naturally lives? All right. So who's next? Come on up. All right, question four. What is attached to another for food or a mate? Is it A, instinct, B, migration? What do you think? You think she's got it? Boom, she's got it. Good job. All right, who's next? Come on up. Bring it. All right. Number one is what? This is pointing to this whole thing.
It's pointing to the lens.
No, it's pointing to the whole thing. What is that? Look at your text features over there. It's on a list. It might help you out a little.
Photographs?
Yep, or a photograph or an illustration. Yep, so you got that one right. Wow.
That's a diagram.
All right, I had illustration, but it is a diagram. It's a diagram. Sorry. All right, so what are these?
Labels.
Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Labels, you're right. So,
Desmond,
he would have gotten it anyway.
What?
You got it. What? All right, let's do it again. Hands behind the back. See the picture? Go. I don't know, judges?
Judges?
Not fair.
Not fair.
Not fair.
Not fair.
I think I already used these. Let's see.
We have the question amongst.
Okay. So let's go ahead and put that one aside. All right. You ready for the question? What is a baby elephant called? You got it. Now let's see if you know the answer. You got it. All right, good job.
No. Great. No.
All right. Wait. Done yet? Not yet, right? Come on up.
I want to know.
You were first. You were. Yeah. Who was first? Sorry. All right, come on up. All right. Oh. Unlike human newborns, calves can stand within A, 1 day, B, 1 hour, or C, 1 year.
One day?
Oh,
a year!
All right, you get a chance to answer it. No, she just said day, so.
Oh, yeah.
All right, you guys go back to your seats.
1 month.
Usually take a little human being to stand.
One year.
About a year, you're right. All right. Okay, next option. Yes.
Good job. Boom. All right, you ready?
Wait, I thought it was
me. You ready? You guys ready? All right, we're using our visual aids. Tell me the two, you got to say both of them, one and two, text features that are shown in this picture. Did you even look at the picture?
You have to say my answer.
All right.
Sierra, it's me against you.
Last one.
You're losing by.
Aw.
You're losing by, like, all of them.
Name. Why do they move from one place to another?
Because it's too cold.
No?
Because it's too hot?
No.
Because they need more food?
Because they need more water and food.
Water and food, and what else?
They need to find a mate.
Faster. And Miss Jones has given me permission to give you all a treat because you guys are all.
Yes!
They were approved. Alright, these are Maniscalco. The students at Maniscalco, they said that was their favorite. Thank you for letting me come in.
Yeah, absolutely.